I'm on an expedition to one of the headwaters of the Chesapeake Bay. I'm here to investigate how even in the most pristine areas, we can affect what happens hundreds of miles away. And what I'll discover has global repercussions. The Earth is a water planet. More living creatures live beneath the waves than in our world above them. But our actions are creating vast underwater areas where nothing can live. These are dead zones. 400 have been identified around the world so far. We are undertaking an expedition to explore these strange phenomena and to uncover what causes them.
I'm Philippe Cousteau. Join me for EarthEcho Expedition into the dead zone. I'm on a mission to find one of the tributaries of the Rappahannock River. And this meadow is part of a drainage basin where water from 6% of the landmass of Virginia flows into the Rappahannock and then down into the Chesapeake Bay. And the question I have is whether or not we can find sources of the dead zone all the way up here in the headwaters where it all begins.
Shenandoah National Park is inextricably linked with the Chesapeake. In addition to the Rappahannock, it's the source of the headwaters for two other major bay tributaries, the Shenandoah and James Rivers. I'm meeting up with park ranger Sally Hurlburt.
Sally.
Hi.
How you doing?
To learn about where some of the water that enters the Chesapeake Bay begins its journey.
It's amazing to me. I look out on this meadow, and we're quite a ways away from the Chesapeake Bay itself.
Right.
And yet, even out here, we're connected to it. The river is not a system in isolation. It's part of a bigger picture, so
right.
to speak.
Here in Shenandoah, we're three of the nine of Virginia's watersheds. Three of them begin here.
Big Meadows is one of Shenandoah National Park's defining features. And there's more going on here than meets the eye.
It's a very important place in the park because it's the home of 20% of our rare plants, because it's a high elevation wetland. And out there in the middle is the bottom of a bowl, and all the water runs down the hill and penetrates into the bottom of this big bowl, and it acts like a sponge, and it holds that water temporarily, and then eventually the water will drain out.
But even here, in the heart of a national park, one impact of people is evident, and it's connected to dead zones. Sally has offered to take me to one of the most special places in the park. But to get there, we're going to have to hike a few miles away from Big Meadows down a couple hundred feet of elevation.
What a spectacular spot.
Isn't this great?
This is fantastic.
So this is Dark Hollow Falls. And the water that we're seeing here flowing down over the rocks actually infiltrated into the ground up at Big Meadows.
Really?
And it percolated down through cracks and crevices and has come out now into the creek and is flowing over the rocks.
And so this is a tributary of the Rappahannock.
It is, yeah.
It will reach the Rappahannock and then flow into the Chesapeake Bay.
Yes.
And then into the ocean.
Right.
So this water right here.
This is the headwaters of the Rappahannock River right here.
Beautiful, but there's something wrong here.
This water looks clean.
It looks clean, but it does have a high level of acidity, which is measured by the pH.
Nearly three decades of water monitoring shows that air pollution, largely from outside the park, is changing the water chemistry. There are even some days when it gets smoggy, obscuring beautiful mountain views.
What happens far, far away can actually affect here, because this feels like we're in the middle of a pristine forest in a national park. It seems like this water should be clean.
Our aquatic life, 6.5 is the minimum acidity where they can handle it. If it goes below 6.5, they start to get impaired.
So this is right now at about 6.5.
So we're right on that edge.
So what is this telling us?
This is telling us that we have a human impact affecting the park.
Shenandoah National Park lies not only within the Chesapeake Bay watershed, but is also a part of the Chesapeake airshed. The air pollution that impacts the water here typically comes from industrialized areas far to the north or west. This pollution not only impacts the headwaters, but that same air continues over these mountains and on to the East Coast.
I want to learn how the air around us can cause pollution in our waterways and contribute to dead zones. And to find out, I'm meeting up with somebody from the Environmental Protection Agency.
Dominique Lukenhoff is an associate director in the Water Protection Division at the Environmental Protection Agency. And she spends a lot of time thinking about what's in the air.
The watershed that we're talking about is 64,000 square miles. Its related airshed is nine times that size. It's over 570,000 square miles.
I mean, that's a staggering size.
Why do we call that an airshed? It's defined by the area or size of the land over which those pollutants travel before they ultimately end up on the land and then in the water.
It's easy to understand the direct link between water pollution upstream, okay, it goes downstream, carried through the water, right, ends up down here. But air pollution, coal-fired power plants in Ohio are affecting the Chesapeake Bay.
Dominique explains that airborne particulates make up a surprising amount of the pollution in the bay.
This pollutant source contributes, it's 30% or more of the problem.
So the airshed is causing 30% of the pollution in the Chesapeake Bay, contributing to the dead zone.
Nitrogen deposition, we found to be at least 30% of that is contributed through this air pollution.
It's pretty remarkable. Just like there's a carbon cycle, there's a water cycle.
Right.
There's a nitrogen cycle in nature.
That's
as well.
Right.
Why is this different type of nitrogen a problem versus the nitrogen that appears all around us?
The pollutant forms that we're talking about are called reactive forms of nitrogen.
Plants and animals need reactive forms of nitrogen. But when we produce reactive nitrogen compounds like nitrous oxides in excessive amounts, it fuels algal blooms that lead to dead zones. When we use energy from coal-fired power plants or use a vehicle that burns fossil fuels, we add unnatural amounts of reactive nitrogen to the air.
And there are a lot of different sources of air pollution, including what's known as mobile sources like cars, trucks, boats, and even airplanes.
While mobile pollution is a big problem, it used to be that coal-burning power plants, like this one, were the biggest offenders. But they've become a lot cleaner due to regulation.
Thanks to the Clean Air Act, the stationary source pollution has decreased significantly. As opposed to mobile sources, like cars, like tractors, like any moving vehicle.
Nearly everyone burns fossil fuels to get around. But Dominique has suggestions for how we can offset some of our individual emissions.
Planting trees, reducing our energy use, alternative forms of transportation, recycling, waste reduction, and all of these activities have the added benefit of helping us to mitigate for the impacts due to climate change.
It's really an empowering message fundamentally, isn't it?
It really is.
That we all do have the power to change the world.
And that's how we're going to do it.
The last decade has seen a reduction in the amount of nitrogen oxide and air pollution going into the atmosphere. And while Dominique and other scientists at the EPA recognize that there's still a lot of work to be done, the good news is that with continued efforts, significant progress is being made. Thank you for joining us on EarthEcho Expedition into the Dead Zone. I hope you've enjoyed this journey and come to appreciate that everything we do, from how we build our cities to what we eat, how we generate electricity, and even what goes down our sinks, has a profound impact on the world around us. Not just the environment, but our communities, our health, our economy, and our lives. The truth is, we all live downstream from one another, and that no matter where you live, the choices you make have an impact on the world around you. And the good news, the hopeful news, is that together we can learn, we can change, and we can build a better world.
What will you leave behind? Cleaner water, healthier ecosystems, sustainable ways to provide food for our ever-growing planet. Everything you need to get started is right on the website. And we want to know what amazing projects you're doing to restore our water planet. Tell us your story by emailing us at education@earthecho.org and share your adventure with the world. EarthEcho International recognizes that young people are making a positive difference in the health of our water planet. Watch as our expedition team joins youth from the Green Team at Fort Garrison Elementary School in Maryland. Go to www.earthecho.org to watch this and other inspiring stories of youth taking action.